Today is the seventh day of this May 1983 7-day retreat. We will read and maybe here and there comment on the writings or the teaching of Huang Po as edited and translated by John Blofeld. Some of you may have never heard any of his words. Others may have heard them a few times or many times. What is important are not just the words, but the listening. The words, if one listens from a limited quarter of the brain, namely the memory, then they may sound old and known and pass by like a wave without any depth. These words are trying to put something into language which cannot be put into words. So is it possible to listen in openness, neither rejecting nor grasping words, but listening open and receptive? The words may not be new, but can the listening come out of freshness and newness? Of not knowing? We read yesterday a short item by Huang Po, all of it written down by a contemporary disciple of his, Pei Su. The master said to me, all the Buddhas and all sentient beings are nothing but the one mind. Both here is capitalized to try to make a new word out of something that cannot be put into words. Are nothing but the one mind, beside which nothing exists. This mind, which is without beginning, is unborn and indestructible. It does not belong to the categories of things which exist or do not exist, nor can it be thought of in terms of young or old. It is neither long nor short, big nor small, for it transcends all limits, measures, names, traces, and comparisons. It is that which you see before you. Begin to reason about it, and you at once fall into error. It is like the boundless void which cannot be fathomed or measured. One person once said to me, how can I trust your words? You can't trust anybody's words, and you can't trust your own thoughts, but you can see. Can you? If you can't, what's in the way? But thoughts? Huang Po says, mind is like the void in which there is no confusion or evil. as when the sun wheels through it, shining upon the four corners of the world. Four corners means everywhere, not selectively. For when the sun rises and illuminates the whole earth, the void gains not in brilliance, and when the sun sets, the void does not darken. The phenomena of light and dark alternate with each other, but the nature of the void remains unchanged. We have occasionally read from the writings of a blind man who could see in spite of being blind. Seeing does not depend on external light. So it is with the mind, says Huang Po. If you look upon a Buddha as presenting a pure, bright, or enlightened appearance, or upon sentient beings as presenting a foul, dark, or mortal-seeming appearance, these conceptions resulting from attachment to form will keep you from supreme knowledge. He uses knowledge in the way of understanding or seeing. It's not knowledge of words and memory that he's talking about, or that this translator uses as a word. Let me read this again. If you look upon a Buddha as presenting a pure, bright, or enlightened appearance, or upon sentient beings as presenting a foul, dark, or mortal-seeming appearance, these conceptions resulting from attachment to form will keep you from supreme knowledge, even after the passing of as many eons as there are sands in the Ganges. There's only the one mind, and not a particle of anything else on which to lay hold. If you students of the way do not awake to this mind, you will overlay mind with conceptual thought. You will seek outside of yourselves, and you will remain attached to forms, pious practices, and so on, all of which are harmful and not at all the way of supreme knowledge. In these readings, words, sentences, paragraphs have been omitted. It's been edited. For the purpose of what we're doing here, making it clearer or more concise. This mind is no mind of conceptual thought, and it is completely detached from form. If you can only rid yourselves of conceptual thought, you will have accomplished everything. Which, if this dances around in one's mind, one remembers it, then one will soon despair of this effort of ridding oneself of conceptual thought. I don't know what the original read like. It's not a matter of my ridding myself. It's more my and me. What first needs to happen is that one begins to see the divisiveness and isolation of conceptual thought. Not all conceptual thought. Thinking is very necessary, particularly clear and intelligent thinking in our everyday life. But all these images of oneself and others, and good and evil and enlightenment and so forth, can one begin to discern thought which is divisive and isolating from thinking which is not so, which aids in the affairs of our daily living without having this me at center stage. So if thought is seen, an image is seen as being just an image and not real, not the real person, then it's dropped. It drops on its own. The seeing is the dropping. And in that there's no willpower or resolution. It happens when one wants to get to the bottom of this self-created isolation and division, wants to see if it can end, dissolve, or whether one is caught up in it forever. Later he says, nevertheless, the realization of the one mind may come after a shorter or longer period. There are those who, upon hearing this teaching, rid themselves of conceptual thought in a flash. There are others who do this after following through the 10 beliefs, the 10 stages, the 10 activities, and the 10 bestowals of merit. Yet others accomplish it after passing through the 10 stages of a bodhisattva progress. The footnote here says, these various categories of 10 are all part of the doctrine as taught by certain other sects, other here than the way Huang Po proceeds. Huang Po wishes to make it clear that though these may be useful in preparing the ground, the mind must in any case take a sudden leap, and that having passed through these stages in no wise constitutes partial enlightenment. But do not now create the concept of this sudden leap. Then comes that, how can I take it? I must take it. And the mind is concerned with how, and I must, and I can't. And that's no leap. That's the old stuff. Huang Po continues, but whether they transcend conceptual thought by a longer or a shorter way or time, the result is a state of being. A state of being. He doesn't say it's a state of becoming or progressing. It's a state of being. Here. Right now. In the present. Because the future is the product of conceptual thought. Huang Po continues, there is no pious practicing and no action of realizing. I do this in order to realize. Then you do this with an eye on that, and you're not doing this. Your mind is there on the goal, and you do this for the sake of something else, which is a conceptual thought. And you're not with it. With the work in itself, whether it's sitting or cleaning or carpentering, teaching, reading. Are you doing it sort of in a rushed feeling in order to get something else, or in order to get through with it? Entirely miss what's here. What is here? And don't have the idea it must always be beautiful. It's what it is. Maybe pain, anguish, the very rushiness Can one be in touch with it once without being driven by it toward something in the future? What is rushiness? All this constant inner churning of wanting. Rather than busying oneself in one's fantasy with the objects of what one wants. Bare of any conceptual thought. Directly touching it. Huang Po continues that there is nothing which can be attained is not idle talk. It is the truth. Moreover, whether you accomplish your aim in a single flash of thought or after going through the 10 stages of this and that, it will be the same. For this state of being admits of no degrees. No measure. Beyond measure. Measure is conceptualizing. Big and small. Lots and little. Better and worse. It says here, our original nature is in highest truth devoid of any atom of objectivity. This itself may sound very conceptual, very difficult to grasp, but it is not, if you look at it. When you read something of this nature, don't read it. Like we usually, reading means devouring words and lines and paragraphs, the faster the better, because then I can read more. I'll get through this book faster. This is not reading, it's looking as you read. Trying to make accessible, to see what could be meant by this. Can I see it? Devoid of any atom of objectivity may mean simply, it's not this, it's not that, it's not this, not this, it's not this, it's not this. Not getting stuck on anything, any state of mind or body, any beautiful form or image or scripture or statue or building. It's not this, it's not this. Not this, not this. It's a state of mind which is freely flowing and not attaching. It is an emptying. Huang Po continues, it is void, omnipresent. Omni means everywhere. Silent. Silent. Pure. Sometimes people reporting on the busyness of their life with overflowing amounts of activity. How can I work in this? How can I? Practice. Yeah, how can one find silence and activity? Most of the time, no, one is totally inundated and carried away with activity. So is it possible during the busy day, engaged in projects or argument, to at any time stop in the tracks and just listen for a moment. If you say, to what? I say, I don't know to what. Just listening. In silence, which means no expectation of what there is, but listening. Silently, quietly, motionlessly, for an instant at least. If one is in touch with the silence, then activity does not inundate it. Does not carry the mind away totally, absorbed in our roles that we play in all these many different roles. It is void, omnipresent, silent, pure. It is glorious and mysterious, peaceful joy. And that is all. It's not manufactured peace. Let's make peace. And act like peaceful people. And inside, things, resentments or stuff are still bubbling and simmering. It's the peace of no me. No attachment. No identification with this or that. So, nothing to defend because there's no image. And an image that comes up, can it be seen? Because images are always at war with other images. It's only when images are dropped can there be peace. Huang Po continues, enter deeply into it by awakening to it yourself. That which is before you is it in all its fullness, utterly complete. There is naught beside it. Even if you go through all the stages of Bodhisattva's progress toward Buddhahood, one by one, when at last in a single flash you attain realization, you will only be realizing that which has been with you all the time. And by all the foregoing stages, you will have added to it nothing at all. Here he says, thus there is sensual eating and wise eating. When the body suffers the pangs of hunger, and accordingly you provide it with food, but without greed, that is called wise eating. On the other hand, if you gluttonously delight in purity and flavor, you're permitting the distinctions which arise from wrong thinking. This is interesting. He says, if you gluttonously delight in purity, one can gluttonously delight in purity of food because there are strong concepts of what constitutes pure food. And ideas of what this pure food will do to purify the body. And it's all ideas, unless one has really, really experienced it. And ideas are very strong in suggesting experiences. One can think one has eaten something poisonous and feel deadly ill. And one can think one has eaten something very pure and for a while get this feeling of pureness, but it doesn't stay. Because purity does not come from food, which doesn't mean that one should eat foolishly, as it's said here, and be discerning of what agrees and what does not agree with one's physique. But there's so much worship of diet or fasting to purify the body. These ideas. You may say, well, you've never fasted, how do you know? I haven't. And I'm not saying it is so, but suggesting that one look at it and to see how difficult it is to separate ideas from facts. And to even realize that they are intermingled. Eating with greed, we talked about that, not really being with the food one eats, but there being the idea of more, needing more. Wang Po continues, merely seeking to gratify the organ of taste without realizing when you have taken enough is called sensual eating. Specialists on this say we have long ago deadened our apostat, has been called apostat, this a genuine feeling of when one has eaten enough. Unfortunately, it usually comes much later that one realizes one has eaten too much. But it's not impossible to bring that back or to get it anew by eating with care and attention and also attentive of the consequences. Wang Po says, if you would spend all your time walking, standing, sitting, or lying down, learning to halt the concept-forming activities of your own mind, you could be sure of ultimately attaining the goal. Again, learning to halt is not a technique to suppressing thoughts. It's questioning the whole thinking process or listening. If you find that you're walking someplace and all of a sudden there's a strange noise and you begin to listen and you listen, at that moment there's no thought, there's just listening very intensely, carefully, openly. Because then you think, well, is it this or is it that? This may be that. And the opening closes again. You're not now thinking. But if you reject all those, no, it may not be that. Let me listen again. At that moment, there cannot possibly be a concept because you want to hear. If you really want to listen, you cannot think at the same time. It's impossible. You must be all ears. Then a word immediately narrows down the space. And then with a word comes, I like that, or I don't like that. Rejecting it or grasping it. And in that there's no openness there. And then we're in our little closet. Huang Po continues. Since your strength is insufficient, you might not be able, here he says, to transcend samsara by a single leap. Transcend samsara, we'll say, to do it. Samsara means our everyday grind. Lived ignorantly, thoughtlessly, inattentively. But after 5 or 10 years, you would surely have made a good beginning. It's not because you're that sort of a man that you feel obliged to employ your mind studying the way. He's talking to this disciple who is a scholar. He's talking to this scholar, and that's why he talks so much about emptying the mind of conceptual thinking, which this man abounds in, having probably read and studied all the scriptures and sutras over and over, probably knowing them by heart. If you read further questions, he asks about all so many things that he doesn't understand in the sutras and hopes that through explanation he will understand. But all a scripture is ever about is about what goes on in you, and you can read it there. But that we don't want to do, because it's very painful, painstaking. And revealing of how we really live and think and behave, and that it is not like the image we have of ourselves, and we rather cling to that than look. But images don't hold up, and they get hurt and offended. So how is one to extricate oneself of pain and sorrow and division? Many people here have said, I'm doing this, it isn't pleasant, but I realize I have no choice. There's no choice. Once that point has been reached, then the work will proceed. And hindrances will be help. Because once seen, there's such a release. Guangpo continues, so it is said that all the Buddha taught was pretending yellow leaves are real gold. Pretending words are the real thing. Of course, he never pretended that. He was speaking out of truth, but putting it into words, we clutch the words and repeat them to ourselves. Wang Po continues, it's pretending yellow leaves are real gold just to stop the flow of a child's tears. It must by no means be regarded as though it were ultimate truth. If you take it for truth, you're no member of our sect. And what bearing can it have on your original substance? So a scripture says, what is called supreme perfect wisdom implies that there's really nothing whatever to be attained. And if that's realized, then this churning slows down. And there's stillness. And one is in touch with what is there in its completeness. Huang Po continues, if you're also able to understand this, you will realize that the way of the Buddhas and the way of the devils are equally wide of the mark. The original, pure, glistening universe is neither square nor round, big nor small. It is without any such distinctions as long or short, is beyond attachment and activity, ignorance and enlightenment. You must see clearly that there is really nothing at all. What is this nothingness? I don't make something out of it. Because what I've made out of it is not that. It is not a word, it is not a thing. What is it? At one point, the questioner says, yet it is recorded that, quote, whosoever possesses the 32 characteristic signs of a Buddha is able to deliver sentient beings. How can you deny it? And Huang Po says, anything possessing any signs is illusory. There is a listing of the 36 differentiating marks. The Buddha, the hue, the form, the color of the skin, and all kind of excellencies of a personality, and a lot of things, 36. And Huang Po says, anything possessing any signs is illusory. It is by perceiving that all signs are no signs that you perceive the Buddha. Buddha and sentient beings are both your own false conceptions. It is because you do not know real mind that you delude yourselves with such objective concepts. If you will conceive of a Buddha, you will be obstructed by that Buddha. And when you conceive of sentient beings, you will be obstructed by those beings. All those dualistic concepts as ignorant and enlightened, pure and impure, are obstructions. It is because your minds are hindered by them that the wheel of the law must be turned. Wheel of the law being turned means that things are being said or put into words, like these leaves, as though they were the gold. Just as apes spend their time throwing things away and picking them up again unceasingly. So it is with you and your learning. All you need to do is give up your learning. You're ignorant and enlightened. He doesn't mean your education, so you can't go to the factory anymore and know how to put something together. This is not what he's talking about. Or if you're a teacher, to forget your subject of teaching, well, that would be grave, particularly if you have a family. All you need to give up is your learning. He means his learning in the scriptures, the holy books. Your ignorant quotes and enlightened quotes, pure and impure, great and little. Your, quote, attachment and, quote, activity. Such things are mere conveniences, mere ornaments within the one mind. I hear you've studied the sutras and the 12 divisions of the three vehicles. They're all mere empirical concepts. Really, you must give them up. He is talking to this particular scholar. He says, so just discard all you have acquired, or we could say accumulated, as being no better than a bedspread for when you were sick, to keep you warm. Well, don't throw away a bedspread, though. You need it at times, because at times we're cold, but do we need words to cover ourselves up with? We do, but we still shiver underneath. Therefore it is written, Huang Po continues, your prostrations are in vain. Put no faith in such ceremonies. Hide from such false beliefs. Here he uses the Sanskrit terms Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi, meaning total, complete enlightenment, is a name for the realization that the Buddhas of the whole universe do in fact not possess the smallest perceptible attribute. There exists just the one mind. And if you say it exists, it's already beside the mark again. Because existence is an idea. The last question put in this book is, but how can we prevent ourselves from falling into the error of making distinctions between this and that? And Huang Po says, by realizing that though you eat the whole day through, no single grain has passed your lips. Not clinging to it, not clutching it, doing it. Being completely there, and then no trace is left. It's finished. And there's newness in the next thing, or in the next no thing. By realizing that though you eat the whole day through, no single grain has passed your lips, and that a whole day's journey has not taken you a single step forward. Do you see that? That if you, with every step, then what is there forward and backward? There's only this in its completeness, in its wholeness. If there's not a churning for the next step or the step, the hundredth step, then you're neither with this one, and you're very frustrated at not being at the other one. And with this come all the bodily symptoms of tension and whatever. A day's journey has not taken you a single step forward. Also, by uniformly abstaining from such notions as self and other, abstaining, not as a resolution and biting your tongue every time you say I, that's a new image. I must be one who doesn't say I. But to see how it comes out all the time. One person said, all day long I sing the song of me, 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 me. Seeing it without judgment, because the judge is also the me. Do you see that? When one sees me arising, one really sees it without judgment, but one sees it, it doesn't go any further than that. There's attention. And that's what's called abstaining, nothing more. Which means you have carefully looked at the arising of me and what this me does and the consequences of it and the sorrow of it, the pain of it, the anger of it, the fear of it, and all the illusions it creates out of fear. You've seen it, you've looked at it, thought about it, and now you're attending. Why does it come up all the time? If you ask the question, that question really grips you. It's a grave, serious question for you. Why does it come up all the time? Then you have to attend. Because an explanation doesn't prevent the me from arising. Somebody telling you, well, in 100 years, maybe there'll be less me. What good is that? You have to attend. And when there's attention, really attention, there's no me. Or else it is not attention. The me comes at a moment of inattention, because the me is inattention. By uniformly abstaining from such notions as self and other, when you find particularly upset about those other people, the other guy or the other woman, that's the time to look. Who is this other? What is the upset? It takes energy and really wanting to do that, rather than persevere in the upset and in the gripe. But if you stop and look, there may be a release from this antagonism. You may see the other as yourself, no different, just as opinionated as I am. Huang Po continues, do not permit the events of your daily lives to bind you, but never withdraw yourselves from them. Meaning running away while you're there. It doesn't mean that you can't cut out some activities if you're overbooked. Say no to some things, no. And create some space in which you can attend and question and look and come to quiet. continues here. Avoid the error of thinking in terms of past, present, and future, which is all thinking. There are times when we have to think of the future or what happened in the past. But most of the time, it just generates pleasure or fear. Huang Po says, the past has gone, the present is a fleeting moment, the future has not yet come. When you do Zazen, sit in the proper position, stay perfectly tranquil, and do not permit the least movement of your minds to disturb you. But you do get disturbed. We do get disturbed. Permit to get disturbed and look at it. If there's attention, there's no disturbance. But if there's inattention, there's disturbance. Can there be attention of the disturbance? What is it? Put the question right there, attend and listen right there. The who, the moo, what is it? Or just breathing in the midst of disturbance. Without knowing what it is. What is it? We will end here for today.